of stunt training I've done has actually taught me some pretty good sort of root principles of movement and danger. And I want to demonstrate that I think actually, while that looks like a terrible jump, I actually did as good as I could under the circumstances. And here's the tracking high-speed shot of that same jump. I come off spinning counterclockwise. I can't see, my mouth is full of soap, I'm very unhappy, and everything goes akimbo. But I'm in midair and I remember to get my feet together and get my hands down to my sides. But I didn't realize that when you're flying through the air, you totally still know which way is up. You can totally still feel gravity, and I can feel that I am rolling towards the back flop to end all back flop. So I'm sitting up against the force of gravity to lessen that. And I consider that a perfect landing. Now I'm feeling pretty good. It's time to go from the top. It did. So this is me from the top spraying myself down. At this point, we're now only using Hudson sprayers or bug sprayers and spraying basically soap solution on just a layer of soap solution just before I go. The least amount of water possible. And, I'll be able, hopefully, to see all the way down. This is Nick, our stunt guy, our stunt coordinator, who walked us through the incremental jumps. He stood at the bottom of the ramp and filmed this. I love this shot. This is my best jump. My form, it doesn't get any better than that. I'll say that, actually, once we finished grabbing, we filmed on this location for 2 days, and then we left four of our crew members on the final day to wrap it up and put it away. And we said, we had safety guys and EMTs and stuff coordinators and told them, we're like, don't slide down that slide. Because there's no workman's comp. If you get injured, and you've been expressly forbidden from, so they all slid down the slide. Willie, the skateboarder, his name is actually Will Nail. Thinking that every time he goes out with somebody and sleeps with them, he should say, "You got nailed!" He laughs indulgently. Willie even tried it a couple of times. All the guys tried it. They all said it was absolutely freaking terrifying, and nobody could match my form. So here's that jump. On the shore, at this point, 72 feet from me, goes, "Fucking A, you're okay, man! That was beautiful!" So I'm feeling pretty good. Here's actually me feeling pretty good after my microphone changed out by Matt and my sound guy. We had to do three more jumps after that jump. That was the, is it possible to fly 100 and some odd feet through the air? Jumps, but then we wanted to know about accuracy. And to do accuracy, I needed to do two jumps to find out roughly where I'd land, and then we wanted to place a target, hopefully that I would hit. So those two jumps, I was actually doing them the following morning, and I came in feeling a little cocky, and quite honestly, I didn't slide backwards, but metaphorically, I was sliding backwards. Here's the first jump. Instant headache. Have I mentioned that the water is freaking bone-ass cold, too. It was like 45 degrees, so in addition to the terror and the instant headache, you were like freezing cold. Oh, and I'll add that the boat that had been donated to us by a fan had its motor break for the, like, 20th fucking time. And the only motor we had for this boat for the camera crew that was in the water filming me was like this little putt-putt inflatable boat motor. And Jane was like, "Well, it works just fine. It moves the boat, doesn't it?" But it moves it like this fast. So I'm in the water, and the boat's moving towards me. I can't tell if it's moving towards me. I don't know if they want me to go to the shore, or I have to wait there in the freezing cold water with my instant headache, and I feel really shitty. And I yell, "Do you want me to go to shore?" And instead of going like, "Yes" or "No," they go, "Rrr, rrr, rrr, rrr." Because, I have hearing aids. I have a congenital condition, not from the explosions. And I can't hear very well. In the water, it seems I have earplugs, and it was just terrible. So you're feeling really shitty, you're hurting, you have an instant headache, and I have to walk, trudge back to the top of the hill and do the second jump. Here's another view of that first jump. That's what it looks like. Fucking huge in this. And he's got like tiny, tiny feet, so get busted. Look at final jump. Jimmy flies through the air without making any noise. It's just not inherently as funny or as hilarious. So it's time to take the final slide. And again, this is now after lunch. We've done the two slides before lunch. Jimmy jumped a couple times, and then it's time for me to slide. And I still feel like crap. I've taken a bunch of ibuprofen. I've got a headache. I'm still not happy about this. And this is what the target that I'm going to hit looks like. Actually, sorry. That's what the target looks like. All right, I've got to hit that. And Nick is our stunt coordinator. Now, Nick and his wife, Angie, are the guys that actually help us talk to the insurance companies. He's a former stunt coordinator. She's a production coordinator. Actually, still current stunt coordinator. They know their business really well. The former two shows they did this for were Jackass. They actually did some safety and Jackass, who knew? It probably was more like a lot of this. Fear Factor. So they have a lot of experience explaining fucked up shit to insurance adjusters and making them okay about it. And over the years, actually, you remember early on we did the episode of the awning fall, where the insurance company wouldn't allow me to fall through the awnings, but they would allow Tori. And this is a thing that we have, you know, I'm an asset to a large corporation, and when you use the word stunt on a form, this word stunt is a term of art that means and carries with it a certain amount of acceptable risk. And there is, you know, for Discovery, not a lot of acceptable risk with its assets, me and Jamie. But over the years that we've been getting trained to do stunt driving and jumping off buildings and stuff like that, we get a little more latitude as we go. And Nick is one of the reasons we get that latitude. Nick comes up, gives us a training session, or sends one of his guys up, and they come back and they say, those guys, you know, they got it down, they know their stuff. The insurance company gives us a little more freedom the next time. It's a really nice thing. Nick comes up to the top of the hill, and I'm standing there in my latex, which is also really uncomfortable, and like can't move very well. And he goes, do I need to tell you anything? No, I've got a question for you though. Are you a fucking stuntman or what? Because that's what I tell everyone, dude. I tell him, he's like a surfer. He's like this blonde LA surfer. Because that's what I tell everyone, dude. I tell him Adam's my boy. He's my fucking stuntman. He can do anything we can do. The only question you want to ask yourself, buddy, is when you land, you want to ask yourself, does my director want another? Please, your director, fuck your headache. He says, all the work happens in here, man, before you leave. Don't be too relaxed, don't be too tense. You know what to do, I'll see you at the bottom. Really, absolutely said that. Pep talk from Nick. And here's the final image. This is shot by our second camera, Scott Sorensen, who's just unbelievably good, doing 1,000 frames per second, tracking me perfectly in the middle of frame the whole way down. This is shot with a Phantom camera that shot most of the Hurt Locker's explosions as well.